welcome to, the best books you've never heard of. That's what we will talk about. And we'd like to include you, but I'll start with the three people here on stage. So welcome, everyone. My name is Nancy Yawa. I'll be your host for 45-ish minutes. I see it's 42 minutes. It's hot, ladies.
It is.
Right?
Very.
So welcome.
We're going to talk about a topic that has been, on the agenda, if you will, for a bit now in the Netherlands. So we're going to also focus both on the Netherlands, but also Europe, because we have an international gathering of eloquent speakers here. So in a way, it has been addressed, but at the same time, I guess it's not addressed well enough, and we should talk about it more. We should continue talking about it. And I think especially here at Winternachten, this is a topic, I think, that's not been addressed that much. And of course, this year's sort of general theme is free your mind. It's a riff, it's riffing off of decolonize the mind. Now I like to, you know, call things as they are. So I would actually want to suggest let's decolonize these 40 plus minutes. Right?
Yeah. Amen.
Amen to that. Well, 1 point for that already. So we want to talk about gatekeeping, race, and the industry of books. Those are the three things that we want to tie in together. It's quite ambitious, but I think it's necessary. What about publishers? What about editors? What about book owners? What about agents? What about scouts? When talking about race, why is the book industry still too white? I mean, you could also put it like that. I have three amazing guests with me. Right here with me, a little bit of a cough, but you're doing well, right? Ella Wakatama, Milo Freeman, and last but certainly not least, Ebise Rao. Three veterans, I would say. We're sort of in this almost similar, same age group, right? So yep. I think there's tons of experience at the table. So let's try and work that out. But I want to start with you, Ebise, because, and we'll introduce you as we go along, because Ebise, you're an editor at Pluim Publishers. You're with Dipsaus, the infamous podcast for women of color, by women of color, but for everyone who's interested in that. But you're also in the editorial team for this edition, for Winterdagen. You're the mastermind, if you will, behind this session. Why do you think this is important?
I came up with this idea because being in the publishing industry, I think now it's been 16 years now. One of the things that I noticed, especially in the Netherlands, is that when we organize literary festivals and when diversity, the infamous word diversity, a subject that is discussed, it's usually writers or poets who are at the table and people are asking them questions, why is publishing industry white? Why isn't it diverse? And I always think it's unfair to ask writers only. Mm-hmm. And because they don't have the solutions, they are dependent on their editors, the scouts. So I wanted that conversation that never takes place on stage to take place amongst the gatekeepers, because that doesn't really happen. I've never been in a situation where editors of different publishing houses in the Netherlands are sitting and being asked these questions. It doesn't happen. Mm. So that's the reason why I wanted to do this.
Yeah. And what is the state of affairs in the Netherlands? In a sort of short clip answer, we'll talk more in depth. We'll talk more in depth later on. But what's the biggest problem here in the Netherlands, for instance, from your end?
Well, it's better than what it was before.
You're being nice. Okay.
I'm being nice, but it's dire.
Yeah.
The situation is dire. and it needs to change. And I think, and there are publishers who are very much aware of this and who are trying to change it, but up until now, it's more window dressing. So it's more in the sense that people want the output to be diverse, but not necessarily the business. Right. The business is not diverse. The output is diverse.
Okay.
And that's a problem.
Mm, yeah. Ella Wakatama, director of publishing house Canongate Books, but the list of things you've done is endless. You're also in these cool juries, and you get around in the publishing sphere. You work a lot. That's a better way of putting it, actually. I saw in your resume, or in looking you up a little bit, I saw your father was also a publisher.
Yes, he was.
And a writer. Has he sort of inspired you to do this? Because how do you get to be in the position that you are?
I think the inspiration is in the fact that I grew up in a house full of books, and reading was always the most important thing. You could get out of washing the dishes if you said you were reading. So I spent a lot of time reading. I want to just sort of respond to what Ebise was saying, because I think that sometimes when the conversation comes around diversity, it sounds as if we, and I'm talking about people of color, we're saying we want to be part of this. Right. I actually don't think that's what the issue is. The issue is, if you look at a country, I live in the United Kingdom. Yeah. If you look at the United Kingdom, if you look at the Netherlands, anywhere in Europe, our job as gatekeepers is to create culture. Mm-hmm. The books that I publish as a literary publisher in 20, 30 years' time become that country's culture. Mm. If the story of minority groups is not within that, your story is incomplete. Mm. Therefore, I'm not doing my job if I'm not including books by people of color, by queer writers, by disabled writers. If I'm only publishing the things that have been published before, the story is incomplete. So if students are then reading in 20 years' time, this is what the Netherlands was like, this is what the United Kingdom was like, it's a lie because it's not the complete story. That's why diversity is important, because our job is to create that culture, and that culture has to tell the complete story of what a nation is.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful, great. And so, Ebise was referring to a dire situation. You're London-based. What's the UK like?
I should correct it. I'm editor at large at Canongate, just in case my boss thinks I'm claiming his job. I've worked in publishing for 23 years.
Yeah.
My first job was at Penguin, working in modern classics.
Yeah.
And I was over supper, I was telling the story of, I would look at the shelf of, I'm sure everyone knows Penguin Modern Classics, wonderful series of books.
Yeah.
I discovered Chinese writers, there were amazing Japanese writers whose work I loved, and then all of the English writers I loved. None of the African writers were there.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, this bookshelf is wrong. It's not a complete bookshelf.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the first things I did, with a lot of help from colleagues, was to bring my comrades Father Ngugi wa Thiong'o into Penguin Modern Classics, Chinua Achebe and Wole Soyinka, just to make sure that when somebody was thinking, what is the canon of writing, that these writers were included. And it becomes a complete story of our world, the best writing ever.
Yeah.
That was then. Things have improved enormously since.
Mm-hmm.
It's still not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot more Black and Asian editors and publishers. There have been lots of efforts in the industry. A little bit too much talking. I mean, the talking kind of bores me. But
and not enough doing, you mean?
Yeah, well, no, there has been a lot of doing. But initiatives that don't just, you can't just say we want diversity. You have to think, okay, if you're bringing a young Black person into an industry that is only full of, no one looks like them. When I started in publishing, nobody looked like me.
Yeah.
Writers would correspond with me, and then they'd meet me, and they'd be looking, well, where is my editor? Where is my editor?
Yeah. Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And I'd be sitting right there.
Yeah.
That is less likely to happen now. It's taken a lot of work for all of us to do, but it has to be conscious and intentional. And you also have to think, if you're the child of an immigrant, as many of us are, or you're an immigrant yourself,
mm-hmm.
working in publishing pays nothing.
No.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're bringing in interns, you can't say free internships. So then you have to pay the interns.
Mm-hmm.
So you get working class people coming in, you get people of color coming in. It's complicated, and it's difficult, and it's necessary.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Milo Freeman, partly raised in this city, actually, but also
born
raised,
even. Yes.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah.
partly raised in New York City, but living, you have been going back and forth, sort
no,
of?
No, no,
or,
I was never, no, yeah, well, I lived there for a while to visit my father, but I was born and raised here in The Hague, and after that I moved to Amsterdam.
And so you've been to a couple of continents, as probably we all have at this table. Now, if I look back at my childhood, one of the things that saved me from myself, I guess, in a way that sounds very dramatic, but I had a black doll, one. And secondly, I had an auntie. I know, right? And I had an auntie who had written a children's book. It's a Papuan auntie. I'm partly Papuan. She had written a children's book that the protagonist was a young black girl who's doing all sorts of things. And it helped me a lot in, well, identifying with her, obviously. You are sort of the person who brought color in sort of the world, the wondrous world of children's books, the Arabella series, right? Let me see. Who has the Arabella series in the house, or who has
children?
Who has
small children?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Did you have children, or you have the Arabella series? Yeah, if you don't have the Arabella series yet, you can actually buy it here. I think they're all there almost, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Very cool series, very beautiful. You're both the illustrator and the writer.
Yeah.
How did you get to write these books? Where did it come from? What was the inspiration? Why?
Well, I think it started about 12 years ago when someone, a friend of mine, told me a story. She was a theater teacher for children. And she told of a group of children. One of the children was a little girl named Jacquini. She was about 8 years old. And my friend had written a little play about a prince and a princess. And she said to Jacquini, well, you can play the princess. But then Jacquini declined. She said, no, I cannot play a princess because princesses are, I forgot to tell you, Jacquini is black. Jacquini is black, and she said, no, princesses have long blonde hair, they are white, have blue eyes, no way I can play a princess. And I remember that moment really well because it just, you know, I was like, felt struck by lightning when I heard that story, and I was like really sad for Jacquini, of course. And I was also shocked and sad for myself in a way because I thought, why is it that I have never, you know, as a black woman, why have I never thought of an image of a black princess? And of course, I understand why. I mean, I lived in the Bezuidenhout here in, and every year the royal carriage,
the infamous
right, they would go through
that's
our streets.
That's in a museum right now, yeah.
Yeah, and we would like run to the window, and there would go, you know, Juliana, Queen Juliana, and her princesses. Of course, well, the thing I want to say is that.
So you saw the physical representation of royalty.
Yes.
Every year in the city. Because the royals live here, or
they
sort
live
of
here.
Preside here, if you will.
Yeah. But of course, I mean, it's just a symbol. But the point is that I did not grow up with children in black children in books, or black children on TV or in movies. Nothing. Mm-hmm. So that's the way it goes, and then you don't think of a princess being black, you know. And a black child for me was like a poor African child. Mm-hmm. Because that's what we saw. We saw, you know, every time the movie would start, we get this little commercial about really poor and hungry children in Africa.
Yeah, the importance of representation is what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
To mirror yourself is sort of key for a child to grow up in a healthy way. And also having sort of, I remember being six and having a white girlfriend neighbor with long blonde hair, and that was very different from the hair I had. If you're not being sort of tickled to see it as a positive image or something that's okay to have, I think, basically,
it's also,
right?
Yeah, I would encourage us all to think beyond that, because of course it is about us seeing ourselves, but also you're describing your friend. Mm. If your friend is living in a society where she is seeing children of different colours, but in the books they never are, it's a great benefit to that child who is a white child as well, to be seeing Princess Arabella. Yeah. I think that it's really important that we don't always talk about these issues. I mean, they do. It's about us, our representation as well.
Yeah.
But everybody is richer for it. Yeah. All of us
You're
are.
So right.
And it's for both. It's for black and for white children.
Yeah.
I was in, it was really, well, striking.
Well, it struck me that a lot of the book reviews for your books were also of white women who were appreciating the fact that there's ethnic diversity in your books.
Yeah.
Well,
as another story, against the other story I just told you about Jacquini, I was in Edinburgh last year at the Edinburgh Book Festival. And what I always do, I read to the children. And after that, I have this big image, a drawing, illustration of Arabella, and I color her dress. So she's already black, but I color her dress at the spot. Hmm. So, and there were all these children around me, white children, and I started to... drawing her dress, coloring her dress, and when I was finished, there was this small 4-year-old white girl standing next beside me, and she said, and then I asked the children, so is it finished? Is she okay now? And then the girl said, no, she's not finished yet. And I said, but well, what? Why is she not finished? And she really had to think what she was feeling.
Formulate her
feelings. Yeah, and she was thinking things. She said, it's her face. Her face isn't finished yet. Mm. And I thought it was, I was like, yeah, you know, it was heartbreaking in a way, because of course she saw the black face of Arabella and she thought, no, it has to be white because she's a princess. So it's just like reverse. And of course I felt her mother cringe at the spot. But in a way I was also grateful for that moment, because I thought, see, that's how it goes. You know, she was so used to seeing white princesses, and she thought...
Children from 6 to 8 already have a very clear idea of social reality, and how we interact.
Even as young as 4.
Maybe. Maybe 2,
Right. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what are some of the hindrances in the industry when talking about these matters. ABC, you are sort of running around all these book fairs. I also always see you sort of tweeting or Instagramming about it. But what is it you see in the wondrous world of the book fairs, and who is there, what's happening, how does it work, and what are some of the aspects? And please, anyone who wants to...
International book fairs, my experience has been specifically London, the two largest ones are London Book Fair and the Frankfurt Book Fair. And again, 15 years of being in the publishing world. It's only last year, 2019, at the London Book Fair, where there were a lot of people of color walking around.
That was only last year.
Only last year that I really thought, okay, this is, I'm not just the only one, and the other black person walking around there is Elisa Diallo, who's a dear friend of mine, but she works in Germany. And then Bibi, I remember meeting Bibi for the first time. Bibi, she's a friend of ours, and also Ella. So there's this 5 or 6 people that, and you know each other.
And you all know each other, probably.
Yeah, because... we do know each other, and I even have this funny anecdote where I was sitting with Bibi and Elisa at Elisa's table, and everybody thought we were sisters. That is an
typical
illustration of how what the situation is, and that's something that I know for me that's a default, so I don't really mind. But I've reached a point where I don't want to deal with that anymore.
Yeah,
in that sense,
there's work to do.
Yeah, there's work to do.
One of the things that I think about a lot is that what Ibiza is saying is completely true, but the problem is never with the readers.
No,
it's the audience, the readers. I found throughout my career that if I put an excellent book in front of readers, they will buy it, they will read it, they will talk about it. The problem, and the reason that this is an important discussion, is with gatekeepers, where we always underestimate the capacity of readers to imagine.
Yeah.
And the whole point of literature is imagining and learning and traveling inside your head. And to my mind, the further you can travel, the better.
Mm-hmm.
And if that travel is taking you outside your own country, your own culture, your own society, and going wide around the world, readers lap that up.
Yeah.
And so often our battle is not about finding readers for the books that we want to publish, it's convincing within the industry that actually things can change, even if this is how we've done things for hundreds of years. Things can change and the readers will take it up. And so I think that the conversation always has to be around that, rather right. than worried that, oh, you know, the readers won't understand Princess Arabella, they won't understand this book, because readers always do. You know, it's a small number of people who spend this yeah. much money on books,
yeah.
and those people all have amazing imaginations.
Yeah. You actually refer to the fact that it was libraries who picked up on Arabella sooner than the bookshop did.
Yeah.
And why do you think that is?
I think it is because the libraries are more in touch with well, the children, of course, and,
yeah.
and
they actually come there to
yeah,
read rather to than read. Just buying it and getting
yeah.
out of the shop again.
To borrow,
right?
yeah, yeah, yeah. And so it's also a lot of more people with lesser means who come there and who cannot afford maybe the books, but. Yeah, there was a couple of remarks I remember at the time when Arabella came out, when some store said, well, you know, it's a black princess and, you know, people from Suriname don't come into the bookstore, so we don't think it will sell. And, you know, I thought it was, I don't know what I should do with that remark, but I thought, well, you know, one thing, because I was really keen on meeting my audience, of course, so I thought, well, maybe in other ways, just to take a step forward and look for my audience. So I thought, what can I do to reach my black mothers and grandmas and aunts and mm-hmm. dads also, of course. So mm-hmm. I thought maybe a way is to go to these natural hair fairs, you know, where they
okay.
buy hair products and there's a really big hair fair in Rotterdam. So I thought, well, I'll book a table there. Bring my books, and I had dolls also at the time. And yeah, and it was just so moving also, because of course all these moms came to the table and they said, oh, finally a book that I can read to my daughter and you know, with a black character. And so that was really beautiful.
Yeah.
10 years ago. Yeah. A couple of years later, I didn't have to do it anymore because they already knew the books. But it's a way to reach your audience.
Yeah, you want to weigh in?
Yeah. Yeah, I want to expand on what Ella said
yeah.
about the difference between international book fairs and comparing it with the Netherlands. As undiverse as it is, mm. when specifically the US and the UK market compared to the Netherlands, it's more diverse. There's more diversity there, and. So being there, being amongst like-minded editors, scouts, and foreign rights managers, I see a lot of books being published which are really interesting and which I think are interesting for the Dutch yeah. audience. But what you hear a lot in the Dutch, within the Dutch publishing industry is like, oh, but nobody wants to buy it.
Mm.
That's like a default answer, but nobody will be interested in that story.
Mm-hmm.
Unless it's a sob story, like... Mm-hmm. poverty porn or something,
mm-hmm.
it's like what the default is like, yeah, maar daar niemand koopt het.
Yeah.
Nobody,
like
standard, will buy
no, nobody will buy it. That's mm-hmm. a standard answer that was very frustrating to me, because knowing, specifically knowing that the Dutch market, a lot of fiction and even children's fiction is in translation.
Yeah.
The Netherlands, it's a very tiny country, but
yeah.
it's one of the, in Western countries, they translate a lot. So I don't understand why within that translated market, there is no space for...
Yeah, missed opportunity,
yeah.
maybe.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And let's also,
but that's
yeah.
the thing
yeah.
that has changed
okay.
in the United States and in
right.
England, that idea
yeah.
of the missed opportunity.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're talking now in terms of culture and representation
yeah.
and so on.
Yeah.
Publishing is a business. It's
yeah,
about making
exactly.
money.
Yes. Exactly.
And so what happens is that you have writers who break through. If we think about some of the leading African writers, Nnedi Okorafor, Chimamanda Adichie, and so on, who are read by people all across the board, those books start making money. It changes the conversation in the acquisitions
absolutely.
Meeting.
Yeah.
Because you're then looking for the next person like that. And I don't think that we can downplay the importance of that.
Oh,
but
absolutely.
As an example, Nnedi hasn't been translated in the Netherlands.
Mm.
This is, for me, it's just, I don't understand why she's not translated.
After her HBO series, maybe.
Yeah, I think then, yeah.
yeah.
Maybe we should. I should just translate it then before
Cross,
yeah. price goes up. That's what I need to do.
That would be the smart
yeah.
move to do right now.
Yes.
Yeah, no, true. Well, okay, you're so right. But then, indeed, I look at the dire situation in the Netherlands. I remember this situation of Astrid Roemer, the one of the most important Black Dutch Surinamese writers, I would say, who got the most important literary prize in 2015, the PC Hoofd Prize, the PC Hoofd Prize, right? We all know the prize. She got it. What happened? There was this radio show. It even got the news. There was a radio show. Two literary critics saying, "Oh God, it's just a political choice." Because really, how can good literature come from Suriname, basically? Yeah, I'm paraphrasing, but this is basically the rhetoric that was on the radio. And the other one said, yeah, it's just political correctness. Now, how do you fight that? Ella, help us out here.
Help.
My daughter says I should practice compassion. I don't have very much. But what you hear in those situations is a threatened majority. And so,
but also just basic stuff, not understanding what quality is when we
tie it to color. Reason for that, because if you've had a monopoly on something, if literature, and brothers forgive me, but if literature has always meant white men, the moment that people start coming in and they are saying that this is literature too, it's threatening a position of power. And so maybe they're right to be scared, right? Toni Morrison, there's a wonderful Toni Morrison quote. Someone asked her if she found it difficult working in such an environment that was dominated by white men. Mm. And in that beautiful, deep, slow voice of hers, she says, no, it didn't intimidate me. I was so much more interesting than they are. And so, you know, that is my response. My heart breaks for this author, but I think we have to face it with maybe fewer words and just more of this and get on with our work.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
No. And that anger comes in your changing the situation.
Yeah. Let's do another example, because now I'm also thinking of, I was talking to Reni Edo-Lodge, doing public interview with her a couple of months ago. I don't know if you know her, but she's written a non-fiction book about race, and it's called Why I Don't Want to Talk About Race Anymore.
I'm no longer talking to you about race.
And it's all about race the whole time. This is why the book sells well also. It's a smart title. But the audience, again, finds it difficult to connect. And you get all these weird... I mean, same with Colson Whitehead, who I interviewed here. You get very weird interactions with people who just, for the first time, maybe through literature. And this is where I think the power of literature also shines through. That they... for the first time, actually engage more in an in-depth way with notions of race, in a complex way even. There was this very, it was heartbreaking. Reni Edo-Lodge was in the room. And this father asks a question saying, well, my son, who's of color, he is married to a woman of color, is being picked up by the police all the time. And he basically was in the corner of the police, rather than being empathetic with what was happening to his son. But at the same time, he was sort of asking advice of Reni how to deal with that. And the whole room was like, oh my God, this is so sad. So in a way, it shows also where we are with the conversation in many ways.
And this was when was this?
4 months ago,
2019.
Yeah.
It's not surprising. Yeah. Can I just say, I mean, this sort of comes back to that discussion mm-hmm. about who benefits from the diversity. Because when we talk about race, I think everyone immediately thinks people of color.
Exactly.
No one ever thinks that a white person has race.
Right. Mm.
And so this is problematic because you're then not, you know, you're not interrogating self or how self can be better or how a society can change. Yeah. When race stops being only about minority, but if everyone has it, and then we start thinking carefully and intelligently about it, I think it improves societies on the whole. And with
Absolutely.
Something, you know, I've been watching... I don't know if this is impolite, but I've been watching people walk out and thinking, yeah, it's quite a difficult subject. Maybe go have a cup of coffee instead.
Yeah.
You know, it's not an easy topic, and so we don't always talk about it.
Yeah.
But it's really important that we are not the only ones in this room with you know, whatever it means, with an ethnicity. Everyone has an ethnicity. And the more that we're publishing and across the broad range and diversity of those ethnicities, the more we all learn and the more we all interrogate what it means to be a human being more intelligently and to greater benefit.
Yeah. And the two people who've been writing about this, two women of color, you were the editor of White Innocence and High White People, which yeah. has to be translated still. But so Gloria Wecker, of course, and did anyone read the book White Innocence? Yeah, so yes, I see some nodding. Basically a cultural anthropologist who is saying, well, let's put the gaze inward. Let's look at the Netherlands at the dominant position, the self-representation. Yeah. And how that works out and how it's linked, obviously, to our shared colonial roots also. Yeah. But also, in a way, Anusha Nzume writing the book Whiteness for Dummies,
yeah.
in a sense.
Yeah, basically.
Talking, having a friendly conversation with white people who in the room, basically, about what it is to be white and how that works for a person of color. Also the interaction.
Yeah.
Tell us about the process of those two books. How did that work, and how did that work also within the realm of the publishing house where you worked at the time?
Well, it is interesting that I ended up being the person to publish those two books.
It's not for nothing.
the first book that came out was Hallo Witte Mensen, Hi Dear White People, or Hey White People. And that was actually, the way it came to be was by accident, in a way, because I was working with Anusha Nzume and my other friend and co-founder of Deep South Podcast. We were actually sitting together with another friend of ours, who's a teacher. Yeah. We were sitting together, we were discussing Dips. We were in the process of setting up the podcast.
Yeah.
And then probably it was at some point in time in the Dutch history where I think it's 2015, where something happened in the media. Of course, there's always something
there's
happening.
There's always something happening.
Was it 2015?
The book came out 2015.
16.
Or I don't know.
Somebody knows better than the editor.
2017. No, but she wrote it 2016. So we were talking about something, some incident happened somewhere, and we were so frustrated by, yet again, it's either Anusha or Quincy, or the default people who are asked to explain what's going on, explain the situation to us.
Yeah.
And then it was the four of us, and we were like, you know what? We need racism for dummies, literally. That was the way.
Was that
we
the
need
working
someone...
title?
No. It was we just need a book that explains the ABC of race and race relations in the Netherlands in a very simple way. And we need somebody to write it. And we were not even thinking in terms of Anusha. We were just brainstorming. And then at some point, my friend said, Anusha, you should write it. And I was like, because she comes from a theater world. She's an actress. She's a theater world. And she can write, but she's not used to writing narrative. And then she was like, I think I should write it. And that's how it literally...
And the rest is history,
yeah.
in a way.
And then I had to pitch it at work.
Okay.
And I had to pitch it, and it was right away. I think you've met him, my former boss. Hello, Jan Peter.
Hey, Pei. For friends.
And he was very open to that idea. I'm in that sense, I'm lucky that I was working at AUP at that moment. So there was no discussion regarding whether to publish it or not.
You had the luck of timing. Let's be real, because
absolutely.
5 years earlier,
it wouldn't have happened.
Not possible at all.
No,
right?
No.
Yeah.
And also that, and the fact that he realized there was this wave that he was very commercial in that sense, and it was easy to work with him, but once I was in the process of producing that book internally, I had a lot of fights with other colleagues. Because they felt that it was about them, that they saw that book as a personal attack.
Right.
So I had to fight internal battles as well, which I kept Anusha, she didn't know what was going on. So I was on my own fighting those internal with my colleagues whilst I was helping her navigate that. I mean, because the response was quite brutal.
Right.
It became a bestseller, but the response was quite brutal.
Yeah.
So it was quite tough, but I'm glad we did it.
Yeah. Has it changed the narrative? Has the paradigm
definitely.
Shifted, you think?
I don't know whether the paradigm has shifted, but I think it has changed the narrative to a certain extent that people have accepted the word wit as opposed to blanc. It's very difficult to explain. I will explain it to you another time. Exactly. But it's,
yeah, let's not
this
do
is
it
this
now.
A long battle that we won because it was it has changed the narrative in such a way that is, has been accepted. And the fact that the race, that whole idea of the Dutch white innocence, what Gloria said, the whole idea of like, we don't see color. That
we don't see race. We don't do race. Yeah, we don't do race.
That's over.
Yeah.
We've won that battle.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah.
The war is still ongoing, but we have won that battle.
Absolutely. Okay. Time is flying, and
yeah.
I still also yes. want to check with the audience if anyone wants to weigh in, but also, so think about it for a minute if you have a question or remark, but I also want, because the title obviously is the best books you've never heard of, so I want from all of you the tip of a best book, according to you, that you think they've not read yet, but also, what is needed? After, you know, we close up shop here, we walk off the stage, but really this is about sustainability. There's still a lot to do. Like you said, we have to work, get to work. So those are the two things I want to discuss, and I'm now checking the room. Is there anyone who has a question or a really sort of, oh, I want to get this off my chest? Then this is your moment.
You all look so attentive. I can't believe you don't have questions.
I know, and I see a famous writer in the room, but she's listening very attentively. Hi, Cynthia McLeod. Very nice to see you. Yeah, she's here. Well, let's give her a hand, Cynthia. Yeah, I mean, you're here. This is also about you and you persevering in a way, right, with your work. Back to you. Best books we've never heard of. Which one?
Currently, I'm reading the book that you commissioned, Suleiman Adonia's Silence is My Mother Tongue. It's a thin book.
What's it about? Why should we read it?
It is because, look, that's the one. Suleiman, yeah. Suleiman is an Eritrean-born British writer currently based in Brussels. And this is his second book, right? If I'm saying it correctly, and he was a refugee. He was, I think he's maybe 4 years older than I am, mm-hmm. and he moved to. First, he did move straight to the UK. I don't know the entire story.
Saudi Arabia and then the
UK. Yeah, Saudi Arabia and then the UK. And the I don't want to give away the plot, but it's the story is written from the POV of a woman.
Yeah.
In a refugee camp in Sudan.
Can I just say, you've missed out the juiciest bit. This is an erotic novel.
Ooh.
Yes.
That is so true. It's an erotic novel written by a man. So it's very interesting.
That's hugely important information. Yes. Duly
noted. It's beautifully
okay,
written.
Okay, sold. So. Next book.
It's a children's book. And it's called Julian is a Mermaid. Mm. And it's such a wonderful book about...
Why?
Because it's the pictures are beautiful. Mm-hmm. But also,
who has an illustrator?
Yeah,
that's
of course,
important.
It's important.
Visual representation.
But it's also a lovely story about a little black boy. I think he might be like 5-6 years old, and he's traveling with his grandmother in the subway in New York, I guess. And he sees a couple of transvestites, all dressed up and beautiful. I think they're also dressed up as mermaids. And he looks at them and he thinks, "I want to be a mermaid too."
Wow.
And first, and then they go home, and then, well, grandma has to do a little nap or something, and then he grabs some of her clothes, I think, and something on his head, and he looks he loves the way he looks. But then grandma wakes up, and that's a really touching moment. You think, oh, what she's going to say, yeah? And then she looks at him, and she says, well, and then but she takes him by the hand, and then they go to, I think it's a sort of a transvestites parade or something. But it's so beautiful.
Right.
You have to read it.
It's fantastic.
It.
Yeah,
it
you
really
had me
mermaid.
A transvestite mermaid. Absolutely. Yeah. Your tip.
Okay, I'm going to choose one of my books. A book by a Ugandan writer called Jennifer Makumbe, and it's called Chintu, spelled K-I-N-T-U. And it's a book that is set in the ancient kingdom of Buganda.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an African historical novel about a family curse that comes through the generations. And it's I think one of the most important East African books of the last 25 years, plus it's such a good story.
Yeah.
And those people in ancient Buganda got up to some stuff. And I encourage you all to read it. It's a brilliant book. Chintu.
I want to read all three. Those are brilliant tips. Thank you for that. So to sort of wrap it up, indeed, what are we doing tomorrow? What are some of the tips or things that you're thinking of or you yourself are going to work on? I co-organized a session about black feminism and the different generations, and we were sitting there with three generations in the room, and the youngest one, Christelle Mugunyende, she's 20 plus, she said, you know, all the stuff that you women have been talking and doing and writing about, where is it? Where can I find it? So really about making the canon more inclusive, but also accessible. Now there's a big problem in the Netherlands, I would say.
Rewriting the canon.
Yeah. So that's one of the things I picked up.
So your question is, what are we doing next? I, in my own head, and also for survival, have to recast this in a very positive light.
Yeah.
And reading is the most important thing in my life. And I think of all the gifts I want to give my fellow readers. And those gifts include reading the whole world.
Right.
And so my job is about, one, how do I find those writers? And then how do I bring them to my readers?
Yeah.
And so I guess the next thing to do is to carry on with that battle, that struggle, to help people who love books the way that I do read the whole world.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you. Yeah. Well, how about you, Milo?
Well, I had the opportunity this year given me by the Sapien Bay to make the picture book of the coming Children's Book Week, which is really great.
That is wonderful.
It's absolutely awesome. But so I'm making a book right now. I've written the story. I have to start sketching the illustrations. And of course, it's about diversity and inclusion.
It's going to be in March, or is it?
No, that's October.
It's October.
Yeah.
Have time.
Yeah, I have some time. Yeah.
But it's amazing. That's brilliant.
Yeah, it's going to reach a lot of bookstores and schools, all through Holland, of course. So. It's great, yeah. Yeah. Can I tell you anything about the story yet?
Of course.
Secret.
Last but not least, let me say,
well,
what's
I guess
next? What's on tomorrow?
What we decided, I think being the co-founder of DipSow's podcast, everybody subscribe, has helped me to channel all that frustration and anger that we felt all these years. So what happened, like we started out as a podcast 4 years ago, and what's happening now, what we're building at this moment, is that we are expanding into other media, other platforms, one of them being the online magazine that we're working on, and the collaboration with Uitgeverij Pluim to have my own imprint. So I just want to publish books that I want to publish.
Oh. Amen.
Amen to that. Yeah.
Instead of chasing the list and the deadlines and my So that's what we're doing.
Yeah, and I love how you mention anger.
Yeah.
I think anger can be a very productive emotion, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, I was interviewing Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, was here for 24 hours a week ago in the Netherlands, in and out. She was talking about this starting point of anger being what led her into the book world. She obviously has this, you know, sort of Beyoncé-like position right now. But there's so much more. There's so much more to do also.
Yes.
And you're kind of going to take care of that, I'm sure. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, Wakatama. Milo Freeman, and Ebisei Rao.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. This has gone too quickly. Thanks, everyone, for listening.
Thank you, Nancy.
That was very quick.